Right. In this session, we will try to discuss about arteries of palm. Actually, here we are going to discuss about superficial palmar arch and deep palmar arch. Before going to details about arterial arches of palm, let me tell you something about course and relations of ulnar artery and radial artery in the palm. As we discussed in the flexor retinaculum session, here ulnar artery passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum. Is it or not? Ulnar artery passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum. If you wanted to be very specific, it is passing through the Guyen's canal, or it is passing deep to the volar carpal ligament, right? So it is passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum, then it enters into where? Enters into palm. In the palm, it is dividing into two branches. Main continuation is superficial branch. That means this is main continuation and this is deep branch, right? So superficial branch, main continuation of ulnar artery, arches laterally, anastomose with the one of the branch of radial artery and forms the superficial palmar arch, right? So this is superficial branch or main continuation of ulnar artery. And what is this? This is deep branch. Deep branch passes deep to the long flexor tendons. How? After passing in between the abductor digiti minimi and flexor digiti minimi. That means after entering here, it is giving one superficial branch that will go superficial to the long flexor tendons, and the deep branch passes deeply in between the abductor digiti minimi and flexor digiti minimi. Right? Then it anastomoses with the main continuation of radial artery. Anastomoses with main continuation of radial artery and completes deep palmar arch. Is it? So this is the course of ulnar artery. Right? Very simple. Ulnar artery passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum, deep to the volar carpal ligament, passing through the Guyen's canal, and it is passing lateral to the pisiform bone, and here nerve will be there. What is that nerve? Ulnar nerve. So ulnar artery passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum, lateral to the pisiform bone and ulnar nerve. Right? As soon as entering into palm, it is giving two branches, or it is dividing into two branches. One is superficial branch, it is main continuation of ulnar artery, and this is deep branch. Superficial branch anastomoses with one of the branch of radial artery and forms the superficial palmar arch. Deep branch anastomoses with the main continuation of radial artery and forms deep palmar arch. Right? So now we'll see radial artery. This is radial artery. At the distal part of forearm, that means here, you can feel the pulsations. Where exactly? Anterior to the lower end of radius and lateral to the tendon of flexor carpi radialis. That means here. Here you can feel the pulsation of radial artery. Then it is not passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum. It is winding around the lateral part of wrist. That means it is winding around the lateral part of wrist like this. Then after winding around the lateral part of wrist, it enters into anatomical snuff box. What is anatomical snuff box? If we extend thumb fully, here you can see one depression. Here you can see the depression. This depression is triangular in shape, bounded medially by extensor pollicis longus, laterally by abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis. Right? So here depression is there. This depression, what we are calling anatomical snuff box. This artery, that means radial artery, enters into anatomical snuff box, right? But as we discussed just before, here deep branch of ulnar artery is there. It is present in the palmar aspect. It has to anastomose with main continuation of radial artery. But our radial artery is present in the dorsal aspect, because after passing through the anatomical snuff box, it enters into dorsal aspect of hand. From here, it has to enter into palmar aspect. How can it go? It will passes through the gap between the two heads of first dorsal introsei. See here, this is first dorsal introsei. It is having two heads. It is taking origin from the adjacent sides of first and second metacarpal bones. So here gap is there. Clear? Through this gap, it enters into palm, right? And anastomosis with the deep branch of ulnar artery and completes deep palmar arch, right? So here, this radial artery passes like this. Here intraosseous muscle is there. In between the two heads of intraosseous muscle, it enters into palmar aspect. If you want to draw here, it is winding around. Actually, it is dorsal aspect of the skeleton of hand. See, after winding here, you can see in the dorsal aspect. How? You can see like this. Now, here dipping, or it is passing in between the two heads of first dorsal introsei. Then it is entering into palmar aspect. As soon as entering into palmar aspect, where it is present? It is present in between the two heads of adductor pollicis. Right? You must be aware of it. Last session only we have discussed. This is transverse head and this is oblique head of adductor pollicis. Right? Now, if you observe here, what is this muscle? First dorsal introsei. And what is this muscle? Adductor pollicis. In between the first dorsal introsei and adductor pollicis, this artery, that means radial artery, will give two branches. What are those? Let me tell you. See here, I am drawing that structure here. This is radial artery. It is winding around the wrist joint. Then it enters into anatomical snuff box. Right? Then this continuation, that means radial artery continuation, passes through the gap between the two heads of first dorsal introsei and it enters into palmar aspect. Right? As soon as entering into palmar aspect, it will give two branches. What are those? One branch to the thumb. What is this branch? Princeps pollicis. This branch further divides into two branches for either side of thumb. Right? So this is princeps pollicis. Right? And it will give one more branch. What is that branch? It is supplying to the radial side of index finger. What we can call this artery? It is artery, so arteria, and it is supplying to the radial side of index finger. That's why radialis indicis. Arteria radialis indicis. Right? So in between the first dorsal introsei and adductor pollicis, it gives two branches. One branch is to the thumb, that artery what you are calling princeps pollicis, and one artery to supply radial side of index finger, that artery is arteria radialis indicis. Right? Then this main continuation of radial artery, after giving branches, it will anastomose with the deep branch of ulnar artery. For what? For completing the deep palmar arch. Right? Let me draw a little thicker. Right? So this is formation of deep palmar arch and course of ulnar artery and radial artery. Now we'll see few more branches from the radial artery. Actually, radial artery, before winding around the lateral part of wrist, it gives one branch. That branch passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum, that we have discussed in the session on flexor retinaculum. What is that artery? Superficial branch of radial artery. Is it? So this is superficial branch of radial artery. This superficial branch of radial artery passing superficial to the flexor retinaculum. Mostly it is anastomosing with the main continuation of ulnar artery. Right? So this is superficial branch of radial artery. So this is the course of radial and ulnar artery. Now we'll see superficial palmar arch and deep palmar arch. Actually, superficial palmar arch has been formed, deep palmar arch also has been formed in the course itself. Right? Now we'll see this is superficial palmar arch and this is deep palmar arch, right? So superficial palmar arch is formed by continuation of ulnar artery anastomosis with the one of the branch of radial artery. One of the branch means what? See here, it may anastomose with the superficial branch of radial artery. Actually, this is most common type, right? Or it may anastomose with arteria radialis indicis, or it may anastomose with princeps pollicis, or it may anastomose with arteria nervi mediana. Actually, along with median nerve, sometimes one artery will be passing. That artery what we call median artery or arteria nervi mediana, right? So that may anastomose with the main continuation of ulnar artery to form superficial palmar arch. Now if you want to write superficial palmar arch, very simple. Superficial palmar arch is formed by continuation of ulnar artery or superficial branch of ulnar artery anastomose with one of the branch of radial artery. It may anastomose with the superficial branch of radial artery. This is most common type. Or it may anastomose with the arteria radialis indicis, or it may anastomose with the princeps pollicis. And one more chance is it may anastomose with the arteria nervi mediana or median artery. So this is the formation of superficial palmar arch. Now we'll see relations of superficial palmar arch. Actually, superficial palmar arch is present in between the palmar aponeurosis superficially, long flexor tendons and lumbricals deeply. These are only main relations. That means superficial palmar arch present superficial to the long flexor tendons and lumbricals. Long flexor tendons means what? Flexor digitorum profundus, flexor digitorum superficialis, right? And the lumbricals, these are structures which are present deep mainly. Of course, there will be digital nerves will be present. These digital nerves also present deep to the superficial palmar arch, right? Then what is anterior structure or what is superficial structure? Palmar aponeurosis. That means as soon as removal of palmar aponeurosis, you can find superficial palmar arch, right? So these are the relations. Now we'll see branches. See, this is arch. This arch gives one proper digital branch to supply ulnar side of little finger, and it gives three common palmar digital arteries to supply adjacent sides of little finger, ring finger, ring finger, middle finger, and middle finger, ulnar side of index finger, right? Let me tell you, one branch, what is that branch? This branch is proper digital branch. What is it? This is proper digital branch running along the ulnar side of little finger. For what? For supplying this ulnar side of little finger. So this is proper digital branch from the superficial palmar arch. Then three common digital arteries. This is one common palmar digital artery. This is second one, and this is third one. If you want to give number, you have to give number from radial side to ulnar side, is it? So once they reaches to the interdigital cleft, these are interdigital clefts. When they reaches to the interdigital cleft, they unites with palmar metacarpal arteries. I will tell you what are palmar metacarpal arteries. They are the branches from the deep palmar arch. Those arteries I will show you later. At this point of time, just you remember these common palmar digital arteries, when they reaches to the interdigital cleft, they unites with palmar metacarpal arteries, right? You remember that. After uniting with those arteries, it will divides into two proper digital arteries. How? See, this is one proper digital artery and this is another proper digital artery. This is one proper digital artery and this is another proper digital artery, like this. Now these proper digital arteries supplies adjacent sides of little finger, ring finger, middle finger, and index finger, is it? So see here, they are supplying to the adjacent sides like this, right? And this is also in the same way, it is supplying to the
adjacent sides of ring finger and middle finger.
And this palmar common digital artery also
dividing into two proper digital arteries. So they are supplying to the adjacent sides, that means radial side of middle finger and ulnar side of index finger. Right? See, in this way, blood will be supplying to the digits. Clear?
So, these are the branches of superficial palmar arch. Very simple. Superficial palmar arch gives four branches. One is proper digital artery. It is supplying to the ulnar side of little finger. And three common palmar digital arteries, they are dividing further into two branches for supplying adjacent sides of little finger, ring finger, middle finger and index finger. Right? So that is about superficial palmar arch. Then deep palmar arch. See, this is deep palmar arch. How it will be formed? Deep palmar arch is formed by main continuation of radial artery anastomosed with the deep branch of ulnar artery. Right? Actually, where it is present? Formation we know. Where it is present? It is present in between the intraosseous muscles and metacarpal bones posteriorly, long flexor tendons and lumbricals anteriorly. Right? So, deep to the long flexor tendons and lumbricals, we can form deep palmar arch. Within the concavity of deep palmar arch, we can form deep branch of ulnar nerve. Right? That we will discuss in the further sessions. Clear? Now we'll see what are the branches of deep palmar arch. As we discussed just before, it gives palmar metacarpal arteries. So how many? Three. So these three palmar metacarpal arteries anastomosed with what? Common palmar digital arteries that we have discussed just before. Is it? So this is anastomosing with this common palmar digital artery, and here it gives one more branch. This is also palmar metacarpal. This palmar metacarpal artery anastomose here, right? And one more, it is anastomosing like this. So what are these? These are palmar metacarpal arteries,
right? So these are palmar metacarpal arteries.
Clear? Then any other branches it is giving?
It gives three perforating arteries, right? So like this, it gives three perforating arteries. These are three perforating arteries.
These perforating arteries passing dorsally. How come? Actually, they are present in the palmar aspect, but they have to come dorsally to anastomose with the dorsal metacarpal arteries. How come they will come? See here. Through gap between the two heads of first dorsal intraosseous, radial artery is passing. Through remaining three spaces, these three perforating arteries comes out like this. Right? And anastomose with the dorsal metacarpal arteries. Clear? So these are three perforating arteries. Three palmar metacarpal arteries, three perforating arteries, and one recurrent branch. Recurrent branch means what? It is coming back for anastomosing with the carpal arches. Actually, here ulnar artery and radial artery will give anterior and posterior carpal arteries. This is anterior carpal branch from the radial artery, and this is the anterior carpal branch from the ulnar artery. Right? Both will anastomose with each other and forms the anterior carpal arch. In the same way, in the dorsal aspect also it will be happening. So here carpal arch is there. So this recurrent branch comes and anastomose with the anterior carpal arch. Right? So this is how arterial arches are. Arterial anastomosis between the radial artery and ulnar artery to supply efficiently to the hand. If you want to describe superficial palmar arch and deep palmar arch in relation with the skin surface, that means if you want to see the surface marking, what you have to do is you have to make one line along the distal margin of outstretched thumb. This is outstretched thumb. If you make one imaginary line along the distal margin of outstretched thumb, which represents the superficial palmar arch location. If you want to see deep palmar arch, you have to make another line which is passing along the proximal border of outstretched thumb. Right? So at this location, deep palmar arch will be present. Actually, deep palmar arch is present 1 centimeter proximal to the superficial palmar arch, right? So this is the description in relation with the skin surface. Here we have to discuss one applied aspect. If there is any lacerations or wounds like stab wounds in the palm, which leads to uncontrolled bleeding. Why? Here so many arterial anastomoses are there. If we ligate here, blood passes through this route and bleeds. If ligate here or if you clamp here, blood passes through this route and it will bleeds. Is it? So clamping or ligation of either radial artery or ulnar artery or both arteries proximal to the wrist or distal to the wrist is not efficient method to stop bleeding. The efficient method to stop the bleeding in the lacerations of arterial arches or arteries in the hand, what we have to do is we have to compress the brachial artery. Okay, if you compress the brachial artery, then you can efficiently stop the bleeding. So what we have to do is we have to apply pneumatic tourniquet proximal to the elbow joint and we have to inflate, right? So that compression of brachial artery and its branches, which leads to prevention of blood flow not only through the brachial artery into the ulnar artery and radial artery, it will stop the blood flow through the anastomosis around the elbow joint also, so that we can efficiently stop the bleeding in the lacerations of arteries of palm. Pneumatic tourniquet is nothing but it is like your BP operator's cuff. If you apply that and inflate, which leads to compression of brachial artery and its branches. So this is about arterial arches and blood supply of palm. I hope you understood. That's it for this session.